This is the terrifying story of the titanic duel fought between the armies of Hitler and Stalin in the bitter cold of an Arctic winter outside Leningrad. It was here that the men of the German Army Group North fought and died with the men of the Red Army. The German forces were so constantly short of manpower and material that they christened the pitiless war they were fighting the Eternal War of the Poor Man. The Russians, too, had to endure terrible hardship. And the siege of Leningrad contains heart-rending tales of suffering and heroism. But the Russian sacrifice was ultimately to be vindicated. For the men of Army Group North, there was to be no such satisfaction. Most were destined never to return to Germany. The ceaseless demands of the cruelest conflict in history would ultimately claim the whole army group as its victim. In late 1940, when Adolf Hitler finally confirmed to the General Staff that he had irrevocably decided to attack Russia, a plan was swiftly conceived by General Marx, which envisaged a two-pronged advance by two huge army groups totaling over 3.5 million men. The German grand strategy was for two great parallel advances, the first aimed at Leningrad in the north, then swinging south to Moscow, and the second at Odessa on the Black Sea. During the winter of 1939, Finland had been involved in an uneven struggle with Soviet Russia to protect her territory. Under the leadership of Field Marshal Mannerheim, the Finns had doggedly resisted the superior Russian forces, but ultimately had to yield valuable territory around Leningrad. Britain had refused to help the Finns, who in 1941 turned to Germany for aid in regaining their lost territory. Hitler hoped to draw Finland into an offensive war with Russia, but the Finnish objective was simply to redress the balance, not the conquest of Russia. Although the Finns would play a small part in the battle for Leningrad, their refusal to mount an invasion of Soviet territory would ultimately have dire consequences for Hitler. Under the Marx plan, elements of Army Group North were to capture Leningrad, then drive north to link up with the Finns and eliminate all Russian forces in the Baltic region. Only then was Moscow to be attacked, from the west and north simultaneously. From the very outset, Hitler found it impossible to prioritize the objectives for his Russian campaign. After much discussion and argument, the Marx plan was subsequently revised to produce three separate army groups, each aimed at a different objective. Army Group North was to capture Leningrad. Army Group Center was to capture Moscow. And Army Group South was aimed at Odessa. With three major objectives to achieve, it was clear from the outset that German forces would be dangerously overstretched. Sections of the German military were very opposed to the venture, but Hitler refused to accept the advice of his staff officers. His gambler's instinct told him that if he delayed, even for 1 year, the crowds that cheered the latest successes so fervently might no longer be willing to follow him into so hazardous an undertaking, and there was surely no greater military adventure than the invasion of Russia. Following the spectacular victories in Poland, Norway, France, and the Balkans, the German forces assembled for Barbarossa expected to fight a short campaign, which would secure their victories throughout Europe. Hitler became convinced that he could crush the Red Army as easily as he had defeated his other enemies. In the spring of 1941, Field Marshal von Rundstedt, who had spent most of the First World War on the Eastern Front, asked Hitler outright if he knew what it meant to invade Russia. The commander-in-chief, Field Marshal von Brauchitsch, and his chief of the General Staff, General Halder, also counseled Hitler against the operation. It was all to no avail, as Hitler simply refused to heed their warnings. Field Marshal von Rundstedt, the commander of Army Group South, was forthright in his views on the forthcoming battle. "This war with Russia is a nonsensical idea, to which I can see no happy ending. But if for political reasons the war is unavoidable, then we must face the fact that it cannot be won in a single summer campaign. Just look at the distances involved. We cannot possibly defeat the enemy and occupy the whole of Western Russia, from the Baltic to the Black Sea, within a few short months. We should prepare for a long war and go for our objectives step by step. First of all, a strong army group north should capture Leningrad and the area around it. This would enable us to link up with the Finns, eliminate the Red Fleet from the Baltic, and increase our influence in Scandinavia. The central and southern army groups should, for the time being, advance only to a line running Odessa, Kiev, Orsha, Lake Ilmen. Then, if we have sufficient time this year, Army Group North could advance southeast from Leningrad towards Moscow, while Army Group Center move eastwards on the capital. All further operations should be postponed until 1942, when we should make new plans based on the situation as it then is. Had Hitler followed von Rundstedt's good advice, the history of the Western world may well have followed a very different pattern. Hitler, however, did have good grounds for rejecting the advice of his officers. While the German army in the 1930s had been building its strength under Hitler, Stalin had been destroying the Russian officer corps. By the end of the purge, the Russian army had lost 3 of the 5 remaining marshals of the Soviet Union, all 11 deputy ministers of defense, 75 of the 80 members of the military Soviet, all the commanders of the military districts, 13 of the 15 army commanders, more than half the corps commanders, and approximately 30% of the officers below brigade level. Stalin had considered himself safe, as he did not intend to become involved in Western affairs. He had made complex peace treaties and alliances with both Britain and Germany, and hoped they would fight a mutually destructive war in the West. Less than 1 year later, however, Stalin's hopes of a protracted war between the Western powers and Hitler evaporated with the brilliant success of Hitler's blitzkrieg tactics, which saw Denmark, Norway, Holland, Belgium, and France fall in rapid succession. The lightning campaign through the Balkans and Greece in 1941 could only produce more grounds for disquiet. Though Stalin accepted that war with Germany was now almost inevitable, he certainly did not expect to be attacked in 1941. He decided Russia had at least until the spring of 1942 to prepare herself. His explosive denials of all contrary information were so fierce that vital intelligence concerning German preparations was kept from him by subordinates fearful of the violence of his temper. As the German build-up towards Operation Barbarossa continued, Stalin's attempts to pacify Hitler grew more desperate. He had already stated, in an interview with Pravda in November 1939, that it was not Germany who had attacked Britain and France, but Britain and France who had attacked Germany. Stalin now forbade any criticism of Germany to be printed in the newspapers. In 1940, he increased Russian supplies to Germany and withdrew recognition of the Norwegian and Belgian governments in exile. In the following year, when Hitler successfully invaded Greece and Yugoslavia, Stalin quickly expelled the Yugoslavian ambassador to Moscow and refused a request to recognize the Greek government in exile. Stalin felt he was continuing to buy time with these unrequited concessions, but his use of the breathing space which he had already obtained was totally devoid of any worthwhile attempt to remedy his military disadvantages. The main Russian force charged with defending Leningrad was the Northwest Front under Kuznetsov. In theory, the Russian forces were larger and more generously supplied with tanks, guns, and aircraft. In practice, the Red Army as a whole proved to be so demoralized by internal disruptions that they were disastrously unprepared. In addition, much of the Russian equipment was obsolete or unserviceable, with the result that in the opening battles at least, there was to be no real contest. As a result of Stalin's purges, the Soviet forces were less than equal to the task of combating a highly professional, well-organized army, which was accustomed to success on the battlefield. Many divisions were between 6,000 to 7,000 men short of wartime establishment. Levies of experienced personnel had been hived off to build new tank and aviation units. Only one of the 6 Soviet mechanized corps had received their full complement of equipment. 3 of the 4 motorized divisions had no tanks whatsoever, and 4 out of every 5 vehicles in the tank fleets were obsolete. 4 of the corps could only deploy 1/4 of their designated motor vehicles, and in another 4 corps, 1 in 3 motor vehicles needed repairs. From even a cursory analysis, the Soviet Red Army and the German Wehrmacht were anything but equal adversaries. In the western part of Russia, the Red Army consisted of about 5 million men, with 1 million in the Leningrad sector. Although the tank strength of the Red Army on the 21st of June 1941 was an impressive 23,108 machines, only 8,000 were battle-ready and in good condition. Of these, less than 1,200 were deployed in the Leningrad sector. Many of the Soviet tanks were the outdated T-26 and T-28 medium tanks. There were even a few of the outdated T-35 machines, a massive multi-turreted tank, which proved to be a disastrous failure in action. In June 1941, the time of the German attack, Army Group North was commanded by Field Marshal Ritter von Lieb and was composed of 2 subsidiary armies, the 16th Army, initially commanded by Field Marshal Busch, and the 18th Army, commanded by General von Kuchler. For the initial thrust into Russia under the Barbarossa Directive, Army Group North enjoyed the support of a powerful tank force, designed as Panzer Group 4, under the leadership of General Hoeppner. For air support, Army Group North could call upon Luftflotte 1, commanded by General Keller. The Stukas of Luftflotte 1 were to provide the flying artillery for the lightning attack of the 22nd of June. naval support was available from the powerful Battle Group North under the command of Admiral Karls, who set about planning the campaign with his senior commanders. As commander of Army Group North, von Lieb had excellent credibility. He had formerly commanded the German Army Group Center, which had succeeded brilliantly in the attack on France in 1940. He was extremely well supported by some of the most capable commanders the German army had in its ranks. As the German officers could draw on the experiences of the war in Poland, France, Norway, and the Balkans, the quality of their commanders was always likely to be superior to that of the Russians. For the great assault on Russia, Army Group North could count on over 800,000 men and 800 tanks, organized into three armored divisions, three motorized infantry divisions, 20 infantry divisions, and three security divisions. Army Group North was by no means the armored juggernaut of popular mythology. 4/5 of the soldiers had to walk into battle, like the soldiers of Napoleon over a century earlier. In 1941, the mechanized era was still in its infancy, and Army Group North needed 200,000 horses to draw their guns and equipment. The Army Group could deploy 1,200 guns. In terms of tanks and aircraft, Army Group North could boast 600 tanks and 430 aircraft, most of them superior to the Russian tanks, and all of them in better condition. Army Group North tends to be treated in some respects as the poor relation compared to Army Group South and Army Group Center. But initially, although there were fewer formations of Army Group North, they actually achieved their initial objectives with great skill and speed. Ribbentrop, Hitler's foreign minister, had successfully concluded a non-aggression pact between Germany and Russia in 1940. Nevertheless, Stalin was wise enough to remain wary of his sinister neighbors to the west. Stalin's overall military strategy required the expansion of Soviet territory to create a deep barrier of Russian-held territory between the Soviet Union and Nazi Germany. It was this consideration which had led Stalin to collaborate with Hitler in the invasion of Poland. Ironically, the secret negotiations instigated by Germany had also granted Stalin the free hand in the Baltic and Finland, which had precipitated the Winter War, which the Finns were now so keen to avenge. From behind this defensive wall, Stalin planned to allow the Western Allies and Germany to fight a mutually destructive war in the West, as they had done for 4 years during the Great War. The early war Russian fighters were already obsolete. aircraft such as the Polikarpov I-153, a lumbering biplane, and the Polikarpov I-16, known as the Ratter, were easily outclassed by the new generation of German fighters. These included the German Messerschmitt 109 fighters, which were faster and more maneuverable than anything the Russians could throw against them. At last, at 0400 on the 22nd of June 1941, the code word Dortmund crackled down the wires, and the full force of Operation Barbarossa, Germany's invasion of Soviet Russia, was unleashed. As they had come to expect, the German armies sliced through the opposition on the way to Leningrad. Faced by the results of his own failures in military matters, Stalin panicked. While his army headquarters desperately tried to piece together the most rudimentary picture of what was happening, he ordered an immediate counteroffensive on all fronts. As the first reports of the devastation he had helped to create filtered through, he was close to breaking point. "All that Lenin created, we have lost forever," he declared, before retreating to his dasher, not to emerge until the 3rd of July. What really stunned the Red Army commanders was that this massive German assault had proceeded long after it had left its artillery support behind. The Red Army command had planned for conventional meeting engagements and frontline battles. The perceived wisdom was that these would develop over days or even weeks. Next would come a large series of complex engagements, and then the real war would begin. In reality, using the new Blitzkrieg tactics, the German advance was so swift that within hours of the launch of Barbarossa, tank columns from Panzer Group 4 were approaching Riga, some 50 miles behind the front. This extended Blitzkrieg technique, especially the bold use of armor, came as an extraordinary and disorientating surprise to the Russians, even to the senior Soviet commanders. Within 48 hours, General Staff reports made it perfectly plain that they had lost control of the situation. They were in complete chaos, and many did not know where their troops were or what was happening. They certainly did not have accurate reports of German movements, and there was no real intelligence, so they were not even sure where the German thrusts were aimed. All that they did know was that in the northwest there was total collapse. In consequence, Stalin operated his usual practice. He had most of the front commanders arrested and then shot. As a consequence of the confusion which raged throughout the army, many of the Red Army divisions simply broke up and formed very large pockets of leaderless troops. Passing these groups of disorientated men, von Leib's Army Group North scythed into the Baltic states, capturing Riga, the Latvian capital. The number of prisoners taken and the war material captured or destroyed in Operation Barbarossa was assuming astronomical proportions. It is hardly surprising that Hitler, his commanders, and the troops themselves now believed that the Red Army must be nearing the end of its resources, both in manpower and in weapons. Prisoners confessed that the German attack had been completely unexpected. Moscow, it seemed, was certain to fall into German hands. Great optimism prevailed in Army Group Center. Hitler had already set up a special engineer command, whose task was to be the demolition of the Kremlin. The propaganda ministry saw fit to make a bombastic statement, announcing that the war in the East was won, and the Red Army practically annihilated. During the early stages of the campaign, the Stuka dive bombers of Luftflotte 1 played their familiar role as the German storm broke against Russia. The initial moves followed the classic Blitzkrieg pattern: no declaration of war and a fast-moving assault designed to disorientate and confuse the Russian army. As the forces of Army Group North drove further into the Baltic states, Latvia and Estonia were quickly captured. These lightning advances were greeted with joy by the citizens of cities like Riga, where the population viewed the German armies as liberators. In scenes of unprompted joy, the German soldiers were greeted with flowers and kisses from the local girls. A great deal of the naval effort throughout the campaign lay in suppressing Soviet naval activity by laying thousands of mines, a task which continued even in the face of fierce air resistance. These ships of Karl's battle group continued with the task of mine laying despite the attentions of the Red Air Force. On land, the presence of a strong armored force in the form of Panzer Group 4 gave Army Group North some much-needed tank support during the headlong advance into Russia. Nevertheless, the rudimentary road system of the Baltic states and northern Russia played havoc with the tanks. Right at the beginning of the Russian campaign, the Germans experienced the problems which dust can cause in motor vehicles. Tanks sustained severe damage from the dust they stirred up while crossing vast sandy regions. Many tanks had no dust filters, and on those which were equipped, the filters soon became thoroughly clogged. Quartz dust was sucked into engines, which became so ground out that many tanks were rendered unserviceable. In other tanks, the abrasive action of dust reduced engine efficiency and massively increased fuel consumption. The sand roads undoubtedly caused problems. They greatly slowed tanks or trucks. They also caused huge dust clouds, which were raised by convoys. These dust clouds frequently provoked air attacks by the surviving aircraft of the Red Air Force. As the Red Air Force regathered its strength, these attacks resulted in serious losses of men, vehicles, and horses. For as long as they were in support of Army Group North, the tanks of Panzer Group 4 played an invaluable role. But even with the panzers, the swift advances of June and July ground to a halt against the tough defences of the Stalin line, which were encountered in August and early September. While the fortifications of the frontier districts left much to be desired, there were still extensive fortifications to be overcome deep within Mother Russia. Although they did not form a solid, unbroken line of fortifications like the French Maginot Line, the heavily defended Stalin Line, or the Leningrad Line as the German forces in the north knew it, was a formidable series of prepared defences. Areas of great importance were surrounded with heavy fortifications, and the German armoured units driving for Leningrad encountered fortification systems up to 6 miles in depth, including well-positioned earth and concrete bunkers with built-in guns and other heavy weapons. There were also concrete pillboxes with disappearing armoured cupolas for artillery and machine guns. A speedy elimination of these strong defences with the means available to a force designed for mobile warfare was extremely difficult. The area of Krasnovardaysk, south of Leningrad, had been developed according to sound Soviet defensive principles and was effectively turned into an outlying fortress for the defense of Leningrad. During early September 1941, it presented great difficulties to the advance of the German forces. Krasnovardaysk blocked all highways and railroads leading to Leningrad from the south, and constituted the main bulwark of Russian resistance. The Russians defended it persistently. Repeated attacks by several infantry divisions were repulsed. It was only taken in the course of a general attack on the Leningrad Line, and after bitter pillbox fighting in the area immediately surrounding Krasnovardaysk. Only the flexible leadership of battle-tested armoured forces, attacking with great vigour, made it possible to overcome the defence zones which had been set up with a sound knowledge of the latest defence techniques. Within a week, the German 6th Panzer Division had been forced to break through and roll up 12 positions, repel several counter-attacks, and take more than 300 heavily fortified bunkers. Like all German operations in Russia, from an early stage, it became apparent to the commanders, to the troops, to the high command, that the task they had taken on, and the tasks they may have to take on, were beginning to exceed by far the resources to hand. In general terms, the forces were adequate for the immediate tasks which Army Group North had to fulfill. It was a very accomplished command, and it did manage to achieve what Hitler ordered to be done, which was to seize the Baltic states, establishing them as a base for further operations in Russia, and move right up to Leningrad. From October 1941 onwards, Hitler tended to vacillate between striking into the Ukraine as the main strategic objective and attacking Moscow, which was the nerve center of Soviet Russia. Army Group North, therefore, came a poor third in terms of allocation of resources. It is fair to suggest that Hitler's high command failed to provide von Leib with enough resources, which in turn prevented Army Group North from achieving its objective of the capture of Leningrad. In the north, the fighting for the Stalin Line proved to be an attritional nightmare, with German casualties soon mounting to First World War levels. The Russians were very adept at preparing inhabited places for defense. In a short time, a village would be converted into a little fortress. Wooden houses had well-camouflaged gun ports almost flush with the floor. Their interiors were reinforced with sandbags or earth. Observation slots were cut into roofs and bunkers built into floors, and connected with adjacent houses or outside defences by narrow trenches. Although almost all inhabited places were crammed with troops, they seemed deserted to German reconnaissance, since even water and food details were allowed to leave their shelters only after dark. The Russians blocked approach routes with well-camouflaged anti-tank guns, or dug-in tanks. Wrecks of knocked-out tanks were specially favoured for use as observation posts and as emplacements for heavy infantry weapons, and bunkers for living quarters were dug under them. Permanent structures destroyed by artillery fire or aerial bombs were utilised as defence points. The ruins hid weapons and served to strengthen the underlying bunkers. Even the heaviest shelling would not drive the Russians from these positions. They could only be dislodged with hand grenades or flamethrowers in costly hand-to-hand fighting. The Russians, when they did retreat, frequently burned or blasted buildings suitable for housing command posts or other important military installations. Quite often, however, they left castles, former country seats, and other spacious dwellings intact. But only after they had mined the walls in a completely inconspicuous manner with delayed action bombs, which were often set to explode several weeks later. These were meant to blow up entire German headquarters at one time. The possible presence of time bombs in cities, railroad stations, bridges, and other important structures always had to be taken into account in German thinking, exacting a great psychological toll. Entirely new to the Germans was the Russian use of forest fires as a hot weather weapon. In midsummer, when the trees were tinder dry, the Russians attempted to delay German forces advancing on Leningrad by putting forests to the torch. Not only the physical, but the psychological impact of such fires was severe. The crackling of the burning trees, the acrid grey-black smoke, the increasingly unbearable heat, and the feeling of uncertainty put troops under a severe strain. Despite the tenacity of a hard-fought series of grueling battles in which the SS Police Division particularly distinguished itself, the Stalin Line was finally broken in late August, and Army Group North surged onwards. On the Baltic front, von Leib's Army Group North had captured the city of Novgorod, a vital target in the approach to Leningrad. The beleaguered defenders of Novogucz had fought to the death, but this resistance too had been in vain. The Germans had discovered the city's defensive plans on the corpse of a Soviet officer. With the Stalin Line broken, General Herpner's 4th Panzer Group resumed its drive toward Leningrad, but without supporting infantry, its progress was limited. Leningrad was a vital center of the wartime production industry, and reserves and equipment were poured into the defense of the city. As the Germans approached, the citizens now formed into militia, divisions of which were flung against the Germans more in despair than hope. Following a basic training period averaging 16 hours, the 1st Militia Divisions were sent to the front only 6 days after being formed. The 2nd Division marched to the front only 2 days after its establishment, and the 3rd the same day it was established. Nonetheless, some Russian civilians obviously felt caught between two fires. One senior Soviet officer later summed up the choices available. He declared, "We were faced with a choice between two dictators, Hitler on the one hand and Stalin on the other. But we preferred to pick the one who spoke Russian." An ominous development for the Germans at this point was the appearance on the battlefield of the Russian medium T-34 tank and the heavy KV-1. Both of these machines were clearly superior to the German tanks and were all but impervious to most German anti-tank weapons, especially the puny 37mm anti-tank gun, which was then the main German anti-tank weapon. The 37mm was so ineffective against Soviet armor that it was nicknamed the door knocker by the disgruntled German anti-tank gunners. These puny 37mm guns were intended to deal with some of the best armor in the world. General Erhard Raus, who fought with Army Group North, left a clear account of the first encounter with the new Russian armor in the shape of the trusty KV-1 tanks which attacked the 3rd Panzer Division. Then, there suddenly appeared for the first time a battalion of heavy enemy tanks of previously unknown type. The tanks overran the armored infantry regiment and broke through into the artillery position. The projectiles of all defense weapons bounced off the thick enemy armor. 100 German tanks were unable to check the 20 Russian dreadnoughts and suffered losses. Several Czech-built tanks, which had bogged down in the grain fields because of mechanical trouble, were flattened by the enemy monsters. The same fate befell a 150mm medium howitzer battery, which kept on firing until the last minute. Despite the fact that it scored numerous direct hits from as close a range as 200 yards, its heavy shells were unable to put even a single rank out of action. The situation became critical. Only the 88mm flak finally knocked out a few of the Russian KV-1s and forced the others to withdraw into the woods. The only bright sign for the Wehrmacht was that the new Russian tanks were still in relatively short supply, and their battle drill was poor. Once the scattered formations had been dealt with, the road to Leningrad lay open again. Despite the limitations of some of its weaponry, by September, Army Group North had destroyed, for all practical purposes, the Soviet Northwest Front. It had virtually eliminated two Russian armies, driven to the outskirts of Leningrad. The collapse of the Northwestern Front was a real catastrophe for the Red Army and brought Stalin to the brink of despair. Leningrad's fate hung by a thread at the beginning of September. But Stalin was to make one inspired move. He appointed Marshal Zhukov to the command of Leningrad, and this remarkable soldier was to prove himself equal to the task. As Army Group North drove headlong towards Leningrad, a further huge haul of confused Russian prisoners was taken in the Baltic states, and a large body of Russian troops was isolated in what became known as the Oranienbaum Pocket on the Baltic coast to the west of Leningrad. The Oranienbaum Pocket was a small semicircle of Russian-held territory, an area of ground that was never to be taken by Army Group North, despite all attempts over the next 3 years, and it was to prove a tactical thorn in the side of the 18th Army. When the 18th Army and Panzer Group 4 burst into the Leningrad area in September 1941, they swept forward at high speed. And as they moved swiftly north, they either destroyed or brushed aside the Soviet armies. One tiny element of the Soviet 8th Army, which had suffered catastrophically from the attack, was pushed right up to the coast. There, around the town of Oranienbaum, three elements of the 8th Army kept up resistance for virtually 3 years. The bridgehead acquired enormous strategic significance. The Oranienbaum area enabled the Russians to protect the island of Kronstadt. This island was vital to the naval base directly to the west of Leningrad. It enabled the Soviet forces in the region, both naval and military, to prevent the German forces of Army Group North, completely denying Leningrad the resources which enabled it to survive the subsequent siege of Leningrad. On September 4, 1941, Senior Lieutenant Darius of the 1st Panzer Regiment radioed back to headquarters that his unit had reached Leningrad. Other units from the 18th Army pressed on to capture Schusselburg, to the east of Leningrad. With the arrival of the rest of the 18th Army to reinforce the panzers on the 8th of September, the German stranglehold on the city of Leningrad tightened further. The capture of Schusselburg to the east signaled the end of rail transport. The German invaders surged on as far as Tikhvin, deep inside the Russian hinterland. Despite the best efforts of the population, the first shells began to rain down on Leningrad early in September. It marked the beginning of a crucial episode in the war, the epic siege of the city, which would last for 900 days.